Is there anything else outside of wrestling that you're very, very passionate about?
I mean, women.
This is a special presentation for the Bleav in Pro Wrestling Podcast. Here's Rick Ucchino on the Bleav Podcast Network.
What is going on, everyone? Rick Ucchino here. SB Nation, the Bleav Podcast Network, AEW Double or Nothing. Coming up this Sunday, my guest right now, by this time next week, not only could he be the FTW champion, he could be one half of the AEW Tag Team Champions. Heck, one might say it is an absolute damn probability. Ricky Starks joining me. How are we doing, good sir?
I'm doing well. I'm doing great. I'm actually really excited for the pay-per-view. Obviously, me and Hobbs have a lot on our plate in terms of things we need to accomplish. So, you know, as you said it, I think you made a prediction. You made a really, really strong prediction that's going to come to fruition.
I would not mind seeing it, that's for sure. And I've definitely enjoyed this rivalry with you guys, you know, Swerve and Keith Lee and throw in Jurassic Express. It's been an absolute blast to watch. And again, as you illuminated, it'll all culminate to Double or Nothing. But I do want to go back to a few weeks ago first. Dynamite in New Orleans, right? No company embraces and celebrates the hometown talent like AEW does, right? Heel, babyface, it does not matter. You got a huge reaction from that crowd. They were with you every step of the way. They wanted you to get that three count. You know, like looking back on that now, a few weeks later, you know, what was that night like for you? What did that mean for you?
What an insane night, especially for the fact that I grew up 8 minutes from the Lakefront Arena. So it was amazing to go back home. My family was there. I was able to wrestle in my hometown, the place that I grew up, the place that I fell in love with wrestling, and to have that, to experience that reaction was amazing. And, you know, I think that was pretty much a glimpse into the future for myself once things start to really get going for me, as far as, you know, how I think I'll be perceived moving forward, if not already, you know, closely there. But yeah, it was awesome to have people from work go and experience my city and the energy that that city has. And not only that, but they experience the energy that the people in New Orleans love wrestling. It's, you know, they love the Saints, they love LSU, you know, college football, professional football, and they love wrestling as well. So it's cool to have that and be a part of that too, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you in AEW, you guys have insane crowds seemingly, you know, every week. And that crowd in New Orleans was hot, you know, adding on top of the fact that you were the hometown kid in front of it. Does that kind of crowd give you like just a little extra pep in your step? Like you always bring it, but was there something special in the air that night? Did it give you a little extra boost there?
Absolutely. Of course. You know, I think too, going into that day, my mind was already just all over the place, just because there was a lot to get coordinated with my family being there and, you know, making sure they were taken care of. And then some of my friends. And then earlier in the day, I went and did like a visitation at a school with me, Hobbs, a captain, Amanda Huber, things like that for the community. And so I was already pretty white before I even got to the venue. And then I got recharged up when I got there and heard the people come in. So it was a packed day. It really was.
I'm a little ashamed to admit it. I've never actually been to New Orleans, right? I didn't get to travel a whole lot early in my life. I'm making up for that now. I would love to get down there this fall. I'm from Cincinnati. I'd love to get down there for the Joe Burrow and Jamar Chase homecoming game against the Saints. I'd love to get down there for that, and I'm planning to do that. But I am curious, what was the best thing about growing up in New Orleans?
I think the best thing growing up for me was the fact that I was able to experience a lot in terms of different walks of life. I grew up around a lot of older people, so I'm more apt to talk and communicate and be able to relate to, you know, older people. And that's just how I've been. I'm a very old soul. So I grew up around these people who were well beyond their years, telling me things that I shouldn't have been hearing when I was younger. on top of that, like I got to do whatever I wanted. I was a very adventurous kid. And so I got to do whatever I wanted in the realm of safety and things like that. So I think for me to experience that, to live in that environment, was great for me, because I don't think I'd be the person I am today. And obviously that's where I fell in love with wrestling. And so you'd see me outside wrestling by myself or with my brother in the front yard, and playing with the little action figures that I had too. So it was cool, man. It was just a great city. It's a great city to be in. It's a great city to be a part of. If you're going to go, I suggest going in October so you don't get melted by the heat.
Were you one of those trampoline wrestling match kids? You know, because that's what we did back up here in Cincinnati. We'd have the matches on trampolines.
No, I actually I was a futon kid. We wrestled on a futon and broke that. And I remember inventing. I invented Billy Kidman's finisher. You know, the one where he gets behind you and hooks you, like. It's like the reverse pedigree, basically.
Yeah.
I remember doing that. And then the next week I saw him do it. I said, wow, look at me. I'm a creative genius.
There you go. All right. You're getting it from a young age. And you may have already kind of, shined a light on the answer to this next question. But, you know, it's like, I follow you on Twitter, obviously. And on multiple occasions on social media, I will see you talk about passion. And I'll see you talk about surrounding yourself with the right people to kind of fuel your drive. And at a very young age, you know, you decided what you wanted to do in life. How did that drive and passion, you know, for you develop so early in life? Where did that come from?
I think it came from the fact that I think we all tried to figure out what we are good at in life.
I'm still trying to figure it out, but yeah.
Yeah, exactly. We go to the grave still trying to figure that out. I think for me, I never did any sports. I never had that type of opportunity for myself to really figure that out. And so when I got into wrestling, obviously this was something that I genuinely love. I really do love it. And I'm already a passionate person by nature. So I think those two just went hand in hand. To me, I think a lot of people get into this or anything and they half-ass it, or they're not fully committed. And I think as a viewer, you can see through it, and you can see who's actually putting in the effort and who's just kind of coasting by. So to me, passion is the greatest thing, and it's the greatest power that you could have with anything. And to not really tap into that is a crime, like, not only against yourself, but against the people that you're putting out that output for. And so, yeah, I just really think if more people understood what passion is and the love for it, we would see a lot of different things come out of it, you know? And on top of that, too, it's also important to, like, be around people who fuel you and you fuel them, because it's hard to do it by yourself. I've done it by myself. I really have for my entire career, but I have people now, and I've had people back then, too, that really pushed me forward and helped me. And not only they didn't have to do anything physically to say, hey, get this guy a job, but just talks and perspective, things like that. That's what I'm about. So it's important. It's important to me. Passion, manifesting what you want, and having the drive to really get these things done is my whole formula. If anyone wanted to ask me what makes me successful and what can I do to get here, really, that's just it. Those three things to me.
I am curious. Is there anything outside of wrestling? You fell in love with wrestling as a kid, but is there anything else outside of wrestling that you're very, very passionate about?
I mean, women. I really got into? So I taught myself how to do Photoshop when I was 13. And so I used to make a lot of graphics. I'm pretty big into graphic making, designing T-shirts and things like that. I like, essentially, I'm passionate about art. If you ever seen my vignettes that I make, I produce those and I direct those, and I make sure that they're shot a certain way because that's how I see it visually. So I'm really, really passionate about that. photography too. I'm really big into my my digital film. So, you know, those are the things. And I hadn't gotten to that till I want to say I was about halfway through my 20s. So, yeah, if this question happened a lot earlier on, I would be a boring person because I'd be like, yeah, I love wrestling. I only watched wrestling when I grew up. So I don't know, you know, I used to be ashamed to tell people that because like, yeah, they're going to think I'm boring, but now I don't care. Like, that's what I like. That's what I like.
Yeah, exactly. Absolutely. And I get the design aspect of it because like when we launched this channel early on in January, you know, a lot of it fell on me. So it was like, you know, just even doing the graphics and stuff like that. That's something I'm not the best at it yet. I've only been doing it for a couple of months, but it's something that I enjoy doing. I like coming up with backgrounds and, you know, images and things of that nature.
Yeah.
Yeah. I totally fall into that. I get it. It's addicting, man. And you know what? These are skills you're going to be able to use, you know, for a long time, right? You're not going to be in the ring for forever, presumably. I don't know. You're in
right
now, but you know, look at the commentary thing. Look at the production aspect of it. I mean, you seem to be setting yourself up for, you know, to be able to stay in wrestling for a long time, even though it may not always be as an active competitor.
Yeah. And, you know, I think that's the other part about it, too, is exploring things that you really may not be good at. And I think from there, it's about once you have the exploration down, now it's about actually, you know, seeing what's the improvement we can get out of it. So all these different things that I do that I love to do easily sets me up for my resume down the line when I do retire from in-ring work.
All right. Hey there, guys. Don't go anywhere. Sorry, I have to interrupt my chat with Ricky Starks, but we will get right back to the man. I promise. First things first, got to let you know that our great deal with Manscaped has now been extended throughout the entire summer. That is right. Our promo code is back up and running where you will receive 20% off plus free shipping on all the great products that Manscaped has to offer, like the Ultra Smooth Package. It is back. It is in stock. That includes crop exfoliator, crop gel, the crop shaver, back now for a limited time. So jump on that while it's there. And ladies, if you're watching this video as well, which I hope you are, we appreciate our audience, everyone out there. Don't forget, Father's Day is right around the corner. Get the dads in your life something awesome that will help change their life for the better, even if it's just a little bit. Manscaped has everything from trimmers to cologne to boxers, so much more. Use our promo code BLEAVPW, BLEAVPW. Get 20% off plus free shipping today. Thank you so much. Shout out to Manscaped for helping us out and putting this interview on for you guys here today. Also, got to give a quick shout out to our partners over at Bet Online. Yes, the continued number one source for all of your betting needs and sports information on the NBA playoffs, Major League Baseball, fights, NFL futures. It's all there. Plus, Vegas casino and poker games. They got everything. Sign up, use our promo code BLEAV, BLEAV, and receive your 50% welcome bonus on your first deposit. Bet Online, where the game starts. Let's get back to Ricky Stark, shall we? So we're roughly the same age, and as a 90s kid, I don't think I could have laughed harder when you called Swerve and Lee a broke-ass Keenan and Kel. That was fantastic. I had to hit rewind just to make sure that's exactly what I heard. And yeah, I saw it. I get it. It was great. I want to talk about the roast game, man. How much prep work like goes into these shots, or is this just stuff that comes off the top of your head, or do you have things loaded in the chamber? How does this work?
Sometimes I may have something loaded in the chamber that I've thought of right before I've gone out. Sometimes I actually they just come off the top of my head. No one in AEW, really no one in wrestling is as good as I am when it comes to roasting them. We have a lot of corny people that have these terrible, as you saw on Dynamite, we had a lot of terrible, corny comebacks.
I saw your tweet.
About me. Yeah, it's terrible. And this is why, you know, some of these people get made fun of by people like me. But yeah, I'm a very quick-witted person. I have a very silver metal tongue. I will slice through you. You may be able to beat my ass, but I can make you cry. And that's how it used to be in school. Like, some kids could beat me up, and that was fine. But man, did I cut deep. I cut so deep that I enticed them. So yeah, I'm just it just comes natural to me.
We know you can talk. How hard was it cutting a promo in Lake Effect Snow in Cleveland?
Honestly, I felt bad for Tony Schiavone. I didn't mind it, dude. It was the wind was so bad. Obviously, the closer we got to the lake, I remember walking out there. I was like, "What the hell is this?" And I already knew it was gonna be cold, so obviously I dressed for the part.
Yeah.
But just standing there and having to talk, I remember being like, "I'm not gonna rush myself." But I think this is a great learning experience to learn how to talk in certain environments. And this was one of them. I was just like, yeah, this is a lot. This is a lot to deal with. But it was beautiful. I thought it was very beautiful. I thought it came out great. Hobbs did not tell me if he was cold or not. I don't think
he was no bothered. Selling it. No selling it. His big chest hanging out there. He looked like he was fine.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. He was a trooper.
Tony Schiavone, I guess he wasn't selling the fact.
another trooper. He was like, I thought about it. I'm going to tell you this. I really thought about this part. I said, what if I just kept talking and they have to film? I would piss off everybody there. But I respect Tony Schiavone and our production crew immensely. So, got in, got out, and then we were able to be warm and safe.
Yes, I wanted to bring that up because that promo that you cut, that set up the match between yourself and Jay Lethal, and the finish to that match was one of my all time favorites. Where you catch him midair, lethal injection, perfectly timed, Rochambeau, 1-2-3. Is that the best counter move you think you've ever pulled off? Because that was not easy to do.
Absolutely, that was probably my. My greatest counter move I've ever done in the history of wrestling ever. And I the thing is I have way more in my head. So we'll see.
maybe we'll see one of those Sunday at Double or Nothing. It's Jurassic Express. They're putting on the gold on the line against yourself and Hobbs, Keith Lee, Swerve Strickland. You know, what would winning those tag team titles mean for yourself and Hobbs, and especially Hobbs, who has yet to capture championships in AEW, what would that mean for you guys as a team moving forward?
I think winning those titles is just a fact of solidifying ourselves as someone who is credible, if not more credible than most of the people that you see currently on television. I think the Team Taz, or me and Hobbs, should I say, has been our story has been a bit of a roller coaster in a way, where we had a lot of ups and we have a lot of downs. And I think having that, especially winning at a pay-per-view, would just be a cherry on the cake there. Here's the deal, though. That is our, I want to say that would be me and, that obviously that's me and Hobbs' first time, teaming on a pay-per-view. So we have that on top of winning the titles. On top of that, we have the idea that me and Hobbs are credible main eventers that should be treated as such. Obviously, we are. And I think that would even just let people know, hey, we're not a group of dudes that should be taken lightly. We stand shoulder to shoulder with the rest of them. Brian Danielson, Moxley, these tag teams that we have currently.
You talk about passion, putting in work. Hobbs has been putting in some work now. What has it been like working with him, watching him up his game and transform himself? He put that tweet out a couple of weeks ago, a side by side of him 18 months ago and what he looks like now. I mean, what's it been like to watch that transformation for him over the last?
It's been incredible. He works very hard. He does. Actually, everyone from Hook to Hobbs to me, we all work very hard. And it's great to see where Hook is. It's great to see where Hobbs is. And it's great to see where I am now. So Hobbs, in his own credit, he's done it himself. He wakes up very early on these travel days, and he goes to the gym, and he works out, he watches what he eats, and he studies, and he's very attentive. So no one can take any of that from him. That was all Hobbs' credit, work, and he's done the damn thing. And I'm very proud to see, how far he's come, basically.
You brought up Hook as well. A lot of talent there on Team Taz. I think that goes without saying. And I think a lot of people saw something in him from the jump, obviously. But
for sure.
for him to become as big of a sensation as he was, and now it's been amplified with HOOKHausen, right? You know, that had to be at least a little bit surprising to everybody that he kind of took off as quickly as he did, at least from a popularity standpoint.
Certain people were surprised. I don't think we were, really. But it is cool to see. I think he has nothing but an upward trend now. So, he's doing his damn thing, man.
Is Danhausen now an official or at least an honorary member of Team
No.
Taz?
Absolutely not.
All right. We'll end it there. Very stern answer. I appreciate it. Double or nothing this Sunday. Ricky Starks, Powerhouse Hobbs, future AEW Tag Team Champions. I'm calling my shot right now. Calling it.
Are you putting money on it?
If I had money to bet, I would.
I'd bet your house, honestly. I bet everything.
Okay. All right. I'll take your word on it. now, if I
please lose, don't I do money. That.
Ricky Starks, thank you so much. Good luck on the floor. We'll catch up down the line. I appreciate it.
Thank you, man.